Welcome to the Retro Remix podcast. In this podcast, your host, Lori Amin, will interview published authors to chat about their work, journey to getting published, and their book recommendations. If you share a passion for books and always looking for your next read, then join us.
Hi, Allison. Welcome to Retro Remix podcast.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
So happy to have you here. So tell us a little bit about yourself.
My name is Allison Hammer, and I am the author of two novels. You and Me and Us came out just about 3 weeks after the pandemic, so have yet to have a book out in the non-pandemic world. Mm-hmm. And then my latest book is called Little Pieces of Me. It's the story of a woman who finds out through a DNA test that the man she adored was not her biological father. Mm-hmm. So it was inspired by something that happened to a friend of mine, and it's told in two timelines, present day as the woman Paige makes the discovery, and then back in 1974, where we see her mom, her dad, and her DNA dad in school, where everything goes down.
Ooh, oh my gosh. That sounds good. So you got inspired by someone else. Like, was it like they did the DNA test, like those at-home DNA tests?
Yeah. A friend of mine, this was back in 2017. Books take a long time to write and a long time to come out into the world. So I walked into a bar, which I know sounds like the start of a joke, but I walked into a bar and saw a friend of mine. And I said, hi. And she said, you'll never guess what I found out on ancestry.com. And so I guessed a few current and historical political figures that I knew she wouldn't want to be related to. And after like my fourth or fifth guess, she's like, I'll just tell you that she got a parent-child match with the man who wasn't her father. And my writer brain immediately went to like, that would make a really good story. Mm-hmm. So I was careful to use it as inspiration. I didn't want to write her story. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I'm a fiction writer, not nonfiction. And also, you know, her story was also her mom's story and her dad's story and this other man's story. And I didn't want to pretend to know anything about them. So I really just took inspiration from the idea that you could be an adult. This woman in my book is in her 40s. She just lost her job and she's getting married. So she's got a lot of other things going on with her identity. And then she gets this email that makes her question who she is and who she maybe could have been. So it's about mothers and daughters and identity and family secrets. And there's Jewish representation and a lot of good stuff.
I love this. And so are you working on something next?
I'm working on a lot of things. I am. I tend to overcommit. My next book that I have coming out is actually a co-written book. My critique partner and one of my writing BFFs, mm-hmm. during the pandemic, we wrote a book together. And so, it was actually about the pandemic, and the editing world kind of said it was too soon for that. So we wrote another book, mm-hmm. and we sold that one in a two-book deal to Berkeley with Penguin Random House. So her name is Brady and I'm Allison. So we're using the pen name Allie Brady. And our book is called The Beach Trap, and it's coming out on June 14th, this coming summer.
Oh my gosh. That's so exciting. So what was the process of writing together? Like, did you switch over chapters? Did you
meet
each other? What was the process?
With what we do so far, every book that we've done together, we're just started. She was here in Chicago this past weekend doing a research trip. We tend to write different characters. So we do a lot of plotting together. Mm-hmm. But The Beach Trap is about two estranged half-sisters who haven't spoken in over a decade. Mm-hmm. And when their father passes away, he leaves them a rundown beach house in Destin, Florida. So over one summer, both of the girls work together, sometimes not so well, to repair the house and their relationship. And they both have a love interest and there's a cute dog. So we each wrote our own character and we edited each other's chapters. So we both edited each other's work. So she had a big hand in both of my solo books, and I've had a maybe a lighter hand, but I've helped her with hers. So it was really a natural progression to go from helping each other with our writing to creating something together. But it's been pretty great.
Oh my gosh, I can't wait. You have to come back next summer.
I would love to
come back.
Yes, I'd love to.
Oh, this is so exciting. Oh, love it. So what kind of books do you read, and do they influence your writing, or do you read something outside of your genre? Like, what's your reading life looks like?
I do not discriminate. I read everything. The one thing I don't read a lot of is like fantasy or science fiction. But I read some mystery and suspense and thriller and romance and, you know, the genre they call women's fiction, which I write, and I know that's a debatable term. But I love stories that make me feel something and learn something and think about something differently. You know, I know some writer friends are really critical of books they read, and I think there's a natural element of that. But I love when a story just like pulls me in and doesn't let me go and makes me just makes me feel. I love when a story makes me cry.
I love this. Yeah, there. I'm not a crier, but there are some books that I'm like, oh my gosh, I'd like to let the tears come. It's just so cleansing, you know.
I cry all the time, and even like just I'm a crier, so it's not a surprise. My first book was a real tearjerker, and yeah. I was surprised the second one, Little Pieces of Me, people have said that it made them cry as well. But you know, it's less about like the actual tears and more about like emotion, and when you feel like a character and story are just real, and you really get lost in it. That's what I love.
I love this. So let's chat about some 5-star binges, because you had a recent 5-star binge. What have
I loved? Yeah, I've been on a roll lately, and I work my day job is in advertising. So I like to tell people I have 2 full-time jobs and not much of a social life. Mm-hmm. So most of my reading is done on audiobooks, and I do believe that counts as reading. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I've been on just a really good binge, and I tried to narrow it down to 5 because there've been so many.
Okay.
But I think one of my like favorites that'll probably be on top of my list for this year was The Gunkle by Stephen Rowley. Mm-hmm. I listened to the audiobook. It is read by the author, and he just does an amazing job. I listen while I'm doing everything, like walking down the street. So I like was literally walking down the street, laughing out loud and crying, like almost within minutes of each other. But it is just so heartfelt and so just, it's just a beautiful book. So I highly recommend that one. Mm-hmm. Another 5-star recent read was The Heart Principle by Helen Huang.
Yeah.
And OMG, I should have learned my lesson from her last books, because she writes such realistic, flawed and real and like genuine characters. Mm-hmm. And boy, does she put the steam in her books. And mm-hmm. I was listening to her audiobook while I was getting a manicure at a place right around my house. And I was listening to it, and I just was blushing because I was like, it's a good thing no one else can hear what I'm listening to right now. Mm-hmm. But it was wonderful. Another one that I read was The Family Plot by Megan Collins. Mm-hmm. And she writes suspense, and it was just the characters again were so real. I just really connected to the story about a family who is obsessed with serial killers. And it's just a really good book that, like, you know, I stayed up late reading that. That's another sign for me of a book that I really love. Mm-hmm. And then I get 2 more, right?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. So one that's a little bit more literary, and I tend to be a little bit more like upmarket or commercial in the books that I listen to, but mm-hmm. I listened to the audiobook of 1, 2, 3 by Lori Frankel. Mm-hmm. And I loved her last book. And this book was like, it was so unique. The audiobook ended with an interview with the author and the audiobook producer. And they talked about some decisions that they made with the different characters, the different sisters. It's about triplets. In a town, it's very kind of like got Aaron Brockovich vibes. Mm-hmm. And it is just beautiful and thoughtful. And it's a book that I was like immediately like, okay, who can I gift this to and send the audiobook version as a gift, because I loved it. And then, oh my goodness, I don't know how to pick. There's so many others.
That's okay. You can pick more than one if you want. So.
Okay. The other ones on my list. I'll just maybe not say quite as much about them. The other ones on my list were Surviving Savannah by Patty Callahan. I just loved it. Shoulder Season by Christina Clancy. It's about a Playboy resort in Wisconsin. And again, I'm in Chicago. I had no idea there was a Playboy resort in Wisconsin. It takes place in the 80s. So We Meet Again by Suzanne Park, who is just so funny, and she writes rom-coms and women's fiction that are just wonderful. And then last one I'll say is The Intimacy Experiment by Rosie Dannon. I was able to do an Instagram live with her around the Jewish holidays, which is so great. Her book has a rabbi and an adult film star teaching a class at a synagogue on intimacy. And I just loved everything about it. So again, it's been a really good reading summer for me.
That is a great reading summer. So I got a question, because audiobooks are like, there are different services, different stuff. So how do you pick your audiobooks? Like, do you get them from a library? Do you use like any of the services? Like, you know, because they're great picks.
I listen to a lot, and I listen while I'm pretty, the only thing that I haven't figured out how to listen while doing is drying my hair. That's literally the only time I don't listen. And so I do it so much. I do have an Audible subscription, but I also have Libro FM. And if you're an audiobook listener, I can't recommend Libro FM enough. It's just like Audible, except it even has more speed options that you can do. And yeah, it's great. And your money benefits local bookstores. So right now I have all of my audiobook purchases going to Volumes Bookstore, which is one of my favorite stores in Chicago. And so I can feel good about you know, supporting an indie bookstore with my audiobook addiction. I have the Libby app, but I tend to just keep buying my books.
It's okay. Yeah, I get them from Libby. I'm a member of multiple libraries, so Libby is great for if you have an outstate library for Brooklyn and Orange County. Those are great places. Chicago has a good selection. They have a good selection for YA.
So, I do like YA too. I sometimes feel like I'm still a teenager at heart. So
yeah, me too. So like I just need like a palate cleanser or something like fun. You just like YA. So Chicago has like some good selection for YA, but there's the competition. I would say like Brooklyn has like a better chance. Like you got to toggle between libraries.
Yeah. So, like, I think I have a couple other apps too. But again, I know how hard it is, and libraries are amazing. Like they are an amazing resource if people can't afford to buy books, or if they, you know, read so many that they can't keep up. But I know how hard it is and how much every sale counts. So I do tend to buy books, but I am a big supporter of the library. I had someone tell me the other day that they requested my book at their local library. And that's actually a really great way you can support an author to introduce them to a library and a whole new audience of readers, which is great.
Yep, that's really awesome. And there's different services and different stuff, so it's like great, like, you know, like support. But I love the Libro FM plugin. I've been switching around bookstores. I want to spread the wealth. Yeah, I'm like, oh, I need to go back to On a Bridge, you know, because that was my local indie.
I was just there yesterday. I love that bookstore.
Yeah, it's so cute. It has like all the stuff. The romance area was lacking for a while, but they found Book Talk and they're adding all these indies, and I'm like, this is great.
I should say that I did a Book Talk. I was, and I've not gone viral yet, so I'm a little sad about that. But I did a fun Book Talk with about my book, but pretending that it was like my story. There are a few authors who have done it. And I was like, I just kind of have to do it. So it was pretty
cool. And, you know, Book Talk, what happens is that they'll share for a while, like for a few hours, and they'll share again in a few days. They'll share a few times. So you never know when it goes viral. So
I'm hoping. I thought it was pretty clever, but I know there's a lot of competition out there.
Yeah. Book Talk is like, that's where the moneymaker is.
It's crazy. I think that readers, I'm so grateful for readers. And I think that, you know, everyone is so creative and just, you know, taking Instagram over into Bookstagram and then being on TikTok. And like, there's just, you know, as an author, I'm also a reader, but as an author, I just love like readers' creativity and their passion. And, you know, during the pandemic, bookstores weren't open. And so people can't get book recommendations from booksellers. So they've really relied, like we've really relied on the readers to help spread the word. And I think it's awesome. So I'm a big Book Talk fan.
Oh, I love this. Yes. I love it. I love the creativity of like just being able to find recommendations. Like as a reader growing up, like I'll find an author and I'll just read their backlist. And that was like my story for until 2016, when I discovered there was this world out there of book recommenders, you know, people who push books and gave us recommendations about like what's a tastemaker, like what you should be reading and all the stuff. And so I'm really grateful there's a world out there and just platforms where people are talking about books. And so we can.
Yeah, actually- I love it. I mean, it's like book people are the best people, and it's great that now there are more ways for us to find each other. So I love it.
Yes. Oh, that's awesome. So Allison, tell us where you can find you online.
So my day job's in advertising. So I was smart with my branding and I got the same name everywhere. So my name is This Hammer. So not That Hammer, but This Hammer, T-H-I-S-H-A-M-M-E-R. I'm that on Twitter, on Instagram, on Facebook, on TikTok, and all the places. And then for my Allie Brady, we're Allie Brady Books. It's A-L-I-B-R-A-D-Y-B-O-O-K-S.
Awesome. Oh, thank you, Allison, for being on the show.
Thank you for having me. It was so much fun.
If you enjoyed this podcast, feel free to share with friends, subscribe, rate, and review the show. This is the easiest way to support the podcast. Today's episode's partner is Libra FM. If you're an audiobook listener, then you should add Libra FM as your go-to source for paid audiobooks. Libra FM makes it possible for you to buy audiobooks through your local bookstore. Memberships start at $14.95, and they also have great sales for romance audiobooks each month for $3.99, thanks to the Kiss Club. To sign up for Libra FM, please visit whattoreadnextblog.com/LibraFM. You will receive a free audiobook when you sign up for a monthly subscription. If you purchase a subscription through our link, you will be supporting the podcast at no cost to you. The What to Read Next podcast is part of the Frolic Podcast Network. Please visit frolic.media/podcast to discover new shows to tune in. Thank you so much for listening and have a great day.